Happy New Year and welcome back to Across the Nanoverse.
I'm excited to share a few tips for navigating the battery industry in 2024. But before we start, wow, 2023 was wild. The battery industry sure is growing globally. In this video, I'm focused mostly on trends in North America and specifically in the United States, but the things I share here can apply anywhere in the world, whether you're in Europe or India, Australia, you know, the battery industry is everywhere. It truly is a global effort. Looking back over the past year, we saw a huge influx of private and public investment, especially the Inflation Reduction Act and IIJA funding became available. And these grants were issued by the United States government to really motivate the growth of the electric vehicle industry. And so a large part of that money went towards battery industry companies. From battery materials mining and refining to cell manufacturing, all the way through to battery recycling. What the Department of Energy really wants is to reach net zero for the battery value chain by 2030. And by net zero, I mean net zero carbon emissions. We still have a long way to go with many challenges, but that means there's a lot of opportunity. All of us can contribute in some way to this sustainable energy future. And energy storage, like battery technology, is a crucial part of that landscape. So 2023, the battery industry was like the Wild West, I heard a lot of people saying, and I'm from California, so I know the Wild West and I'm an expert. So yes, it's like the Wild West. No, I'm just kidding. But the industry is in its early stages, which means that we have the power to form it in a way that is sustainable and equitable. We don't have to repeat the mistakes of the fossil fuel industry. As we work towards that net zero goal, we can do things differently. Hello, innovation. So looking into 2024, what do we see? Interest rates are high, the price of lithium is low, and we just had, unfortunately, quite a few layoffs in the battery industry. Despite this, there's more opportunity than ever. I'm about to go into the tips, but remember, take everything I say with a grain of salt. You know what's best for you, your health, your wellness, your happiness, your curiosity, and these are all just suggestions. My first tip is to position yourself in an industry hotspot, where the action is happening. A good way to find those industry hotspots is to follow the flow of money and investment dollars. So this could be companies that are receiving grants from the Department of Energy or like the Inflation Reduction Act. And there's hotspots across the whole entire battery value chain, from the mining and refining area to gigafactories, cell manufacturing, battery manufacturing, all the way through to battery recycling. It's pretty wild that nearly every single automotive OEM is establishing a battery R&D team. So there's opportunities to work on new next-gen battery cell chemistries, like silicon anodes and zinc or sodium ion batteries. And you don't necessarily have to be in a startup company to be doing that work. Which leads me to my second tip is, do you want to work in a startup or a small company or a large established company? There's definitely pros and cons for each. I've had experience in both. And in a startup company or in a smaller company, you have more opportunity to, as they say, wear more hats or take on different roles. So if you're an engineer, you can do also business development or other positions within the company. While it can be very volatile to be in a startup and you may not have as secure of a job as in a larger company, you'll have the ability to really innovate, move quickly, and be disruptive within that small company. Versus a larger company is more established, has a certain status quo of operating. And what's happening in a lot of these larger companies is they're building out new departments or new teams. And so there's a lot of internal reorganization happening. When I'm working in a larger company like I am now, I'm essentially creating a startup within a larger company that's focused on battery technology. Although large companies tend not to be as quickly innovative and stick to the status quo for the most part, there are a lot of shifts in larger companies with this trend towards electrification. And so you can find yourself in a larger company kind of doing a startup type of endeavor, making a new department or new part of the business that focuses on battery technology. Knowing which style you like, whether you like to move quickly and be disruptive in a smaller startup type of environment, or you like to be part of a larger organization going through a slower change, that's important to know. the companies that are perhaps the slowest and most reactive to this change and trend in electrification are utilities and oil and gas companies. But what's interesting is they are starting to employ battery engineers and people who know battery technology. My third tip is to position yourself in a role where you're using your strengths, but you're gaining a new skill set in this emerging area of battery technology. For instance, you may come from aerospace or a manufacturing environment, and so many skills in these different areas or engineering disciplines are transferable into the battery industry. That demand for a battery engineering skill set is the highest right now, especially because many don't have those qualifications. And that's an advantage if you do want to go and work as a battery engineer, because the company may be more lenient on what your qualifications are to go into that role. So finding where your skill set is transferable into that role is important if you want to pivot your career in that direction. Being interdisciplinary in your skill set is a huge strength in the battery industry. And speaking of interdisciplinary skill sets, this leads us to tip number 4. I really see a trend where certain skill sets, specifically in implementing sustainable practices and implementing inclusive and equitable practices, those are on the rise right now. Plus, throw in an entrepreneurial skill set, and yes, that is definitely in high demand right now. I've seen this exemplified in Department of Energy grants. There's now 20% of the grant itself is judged based on its community benefits plan. If you're able to solve a technical problem and also benefit a community, this is your time to shine. Not just that, but this industry is very volatile, and studies have shown that a diverse workplace actually fosters innovation and returns higher profits. Plus, there's a workforce shortage in the battery industry, and so the ability to hire a diverse group of people to work at your company is more and more critical, as well as retaining those diverse employees. High turnover rates cost a company a lot of money, and we can't design our sustainable energy future to be sustainable for the 1%. It has to be sustainable for the 100%, and therefore understanding how to implement sustainable practices, equitable practices, is a key part of being successful at reaching those net zero goals. And if you don't have these specific skill sets, I have tip number 5 for you, which is I think there's going to be a trend in using more and more informal education to gain more skills. Informal education just means you're not sitting in a traditional classroom environment. That's what they call formal education. Informal education includes what you can learn from professional societies or from online courses, for instance. And as we're working in this industry and learning on the job, we don't necessarily have time to go to college to get a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, or a PhD. That's where it's an advantage to use online resources to learn and supplement what you're learning at your job. Additionally, many degree programs don't have specific curricula on battery engineering or battery technology topics. When I was in grad school a decade ago, I just took one electrochemistry class in which maybe half a chapter was dedicated to energy storage technologies. I basically learned it all on the job. And don't worry about falling behind, because the whole industry is learning together at this point, which makes it a great time to join a professional organization or society like the Volta Foundation or NatBat or the Electrochemical Society. And if you don't know even where to start on looking for educational resources in the industry, please check out the description below. I have a resource for you called Battery Industry Onboarding that shares these educational resources and professional societies that you can join directly to your inbox. Be sure to subscribe to that and this YouTube channel for those resources. And this brings us to my last final tip of this video, which is to surround yourself with a team that is supportive of your learning. Even if you work in that hot spot in the industry, you're learning a lot, but you're surrounded by a team that's putting you down, that's not a recipe for success. You deserve to feel safe and comfortable in your work environment. Even if you're new, you should not be harassed or put down. Join a team where you will be supported in learning and working. And if you are experiencing harassment, I do have resources in the description below for you. You are definitely not alone. I've been there.
And that concludes my 6 tips for working in the battery industry in 2024. If you have any additional tips you would like to share, please comment them below. I'd love to hear your perspective. If you found this video helpful, please like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching. Happy New Year, and I'll talk to you next year. Is that a cheesy thing to say?